chill polishing. The lesson for today. Now what I did is I picked the most popular windscreen polishing kit on Amazon. I have never tried this, and it literally is called windscreen polishing kit. It comes in a very small package like this. It's got two different types of polishing pads. It's got the polishing compound, whatever you want to call it. Now, the general rule when it comes to glass polishing, if you want to actually polish it in the mechanical type, and what I mean by mechanical is that it actually contains some form of abrasives. It is called cerium oxide. That is the ingredient that you will see in virtually every type of glass polishing kit. So let's see on the Audi, which I will introduce to you shortly, as to how effective this actually is. Part of the directions say that you need to use an electric drill motor versus a cordless, because a cordless cannot generate enough RPMs to actually make this effective. So that's where it comes to polishing, is you've got a lot of variables from not only the pressure, how long you sustain the pad in a specific area, but the RPM specifically itself. And that's where friction and the ability to generate enough heat and friction. You also have your pad material, your compound material. So all those combine together to create a process or a product that's either effective or less effective. Now you can control so much or certain parts of those variables, but that's where choosing the right kit as to the pad, the compound, and what have you will come into play. So let's get started. Here we have a shot of the front of the glass. The tape is located on the inside of the windshield so that when I'm working on the outside of the windshield, I can see exactly the areas that I need to address, because as you change the lighting, as I change positions while I'm working on the glass, often the scratch will disappear. So the tape itself will help me as a guide as I'm polishing back and forth to know where the scratches originate from. My goal is to try to capture this in different lighting so that you can see. Here's the heaviest of the scratches right through here. And it's created from the windshield wipers themselves, so it makes the exact pattern of the wiper blade, and they extend all the way down to here where I have the finished part of the edge of the final scratch. So I'll move this in different angles. Hopefully it will capture it. Here we have the inside. The scratches are here. So I'll pull back, and it's tough because you've got this whole back drop that's coming through the glass, but the scratches are right along here. And I'm just gonna try different angles with the hopes of capturing those scratches. So you can see the before and after. Right now we have the before shot. We'll see how the product performs. A couple things that I like to do whenever polishing is involved, and what I mean by that is whether it's liquid compounds or liquid polishes, is safe polishing, but also it's not about risk management necessarily or all the time. What I'm also protecting by taping up the A-pillar and the line that separates the windshield from the paint, as well as the wiper blade itself. Because as you polish, you're gonna naturally get what's called sling. Some of your compound or polish is going to sling outside the boundaries, and it's going to create a mess. So this not only serves as protection in the event that I'm polishing and I catch an edge, which I don't wanna do, but it also protects the sling, so that the cleanup is far easier. So instead of getting sling and all these nuances of the car itself, the wiper blade, the line separation here, what have you, now it's a simple cleanup by just peeling the tape off. So let's get started. I've got my pad in place. It comes with a backing plate that you simply attach to the drill motor. Then it's got a Velcro glass polishing disc that you attach to that. Remember, the rule is that you always read the directions first. When it comes to a brand new container, I always take the cap off to make sure there's not some protection cap in place that has to be removed. So I verified that. I'm ready to apply some compound pad. Based on the directions, I put about 5 to 6 pea-sized drops on the pad itself. Also, as a rule, I always close the container because if this is sitting in the sun, or it sits on its side, or it falls over while you don't expect it, I don't want to make a mess. I'm also working in the shade. As a rule, virtually everything will work better in the shade. Any heat and friction that I want to produce, I want it to be from the drill motor itself rather than a hot surface already. Now, if you've been following my channel for any length of time, you know that as a rule, I do most of my work in the direct sunlight. But if I have a choice, I'm going to opt for the shade and be able to control all the heat from this versus a balance act between the heated up surface and the heat that is generated by the machine itself. Something you're supposed to do is check the windshield as you polish. You don't want the windshield to get too hot. Of course, too hot is subjective, meaning unless you have the ability to measure the surface temperature, how do you know what too hot or not hot enough is? That's a judgment call that only you can make. My rule of thumb is this. If I can lay my hand on the surface for 20 seconds and then it starts to burn where I can't leave my hand there, I know that I would consider that a very hot surface. But if I can leave my hand there for at least a minute and it's not literally burning my hand, then I'm just gonna call that a hot surface rather than very hot. So if I have to pull my hand away, that's too hot. If I can leave it there for at least a minute, that's just hot. Might be too hot, but it's just hot. That's where you have to make a judgment call. This is barely warm, based on what you just saw. What you also observed is how the drill motor wants to get away from me and start doing speed wobbles. That's because this is a very small disc, and essentially this drill motor is replicating a rotary polisher, which means that it only spins on one single axis point versus a random dual action polisher. But they need this type of polisher because it will generate the friction and the heat necessary to actually polish the glass. Glass is very strong, far stronger than clear coat. So this is an entirely different animal. But, and if this is your first rodeo, just know that when you start polishing, chances are your drill motor is going to be all over the board because it is hard to control. It's only because I have some experience, or actually I have a lot of experience with a rotary, that I know that the subtlest tilt of this drill motor is going to affect which way the motor wants to pull itself. So when I'm in here drilling or polishing, you really have to be very aware as to how you control the pad, its placement, so it's gonna be all over the board. Just be prepared for that. You will learn to finesse it. You will learn that when you tilt it a little to the left, to the right, forward, backward. And when I say tilt, even though I was over dramatizing it, it's gonna be the subtlest of tilts, where you will literally have to finesse it to try to keep a smooth pattern moving forward. And I can tell already that yes, it's polishing it, but I can still see the deep scratches. So I'm going to reapply the compound, do some more polishing, and at least see how much I can diminish or remove these deeper scratches. I've got the core draped over my shoulder so that it's not dragging itself all over the paint and doing other damage that I will have to fix later. I've added another 5 pea-sized drops to it, and I'm gonna go in for round 2. And you'll notice that this is a variable speed drill motor, so that I can ramp up the drill speed. I don't have to come in hot and level 10. I can ease into it. It comes with a little tiny microfiber cloth. So I'm gonna polish this off. And once again, this, whether you're polishing paint, polishing glass, this is where you have a lot of control. Speed, pressure, duration, how much product you use, you have a lot of control. So if you're fearful, whether you're, once again, polishing paint or glass, just ease into it. Wade into it rather than jumping into the deep end. So I have now done two passes. The deep scratches are still there. I cannot catch them with a fingernail, but I can still see them. So I know that I have, at a minimum, diminished the scratches. I have also polished away the edge of the scratch, but in fact, they're still there. So let me try a third pass. And this manual that comes with the directions of this kit has pictures for you, and it shows a very thick slurry of compound and polish. So this time, rather than approaching it with, based on my experience as a detailer, I'm going to approach it the way they show, which to me, meaning the polish is either going to work or it's not. The pad itself, the polish, the combination is either going to work or not. Unfortunately, in society, we are trained with the more is always better approach. If you're a beginner, you will default to, as a rule, an excessive amount of polish. So based on their picture and their directions, that looks like an excessive amount of polish because the comp or the particles in it are either going to work or they're not. I know that just because I'm gonna use more does not mean it's going to make those particles more effective. But in defense of this package, I'm going to use more to try to replicate the picture that they show in the little manual. Now specifically, the directions say add half a teaspoon of polish in the middle. It would be hard to measure that, but I have a pretty good eye for measurements. So this is what I would call going in hot, where that's a lot of polish. But once again, as I say, as a rule, I'm going to default to the manufacturer's directions first, then finesse it. I kind of went in reverse based on my experience. So let's now see if by using more polish, I can eliminate these deeper scratches. Even with that much polishing, this windshield is not heating up. It's barely even getting warm. I'm very surprised, but to me, that has more to do with the speed of this drill motor. Like, I could pick a different drill motor that can actually produce more RPMs, and that would heat up this surface even higher. So that's where you have to finesse it. If you don't have a drill motor that can generate a lot of RPMs, that's just gonna require you to stay on the surface or the area longer and allow those abrasives to just sit there and grind and polish and do their job, rather than kind of, I hate to use the word force, but that's where you can tweak it, is by greater RPM speed that will then produce more heat, more friction, and allow the compound to work quicker rather than slower. So after pass number three, I can still see the deeper scratches, but it's harder to see them. So I know that if I continue to just do pass after pass after pass, it's going to eliminate these eventually. The question is you have to assess what I call the ROI, your return on investment. The investment in this moment is the kit itself, which is pretty trivial, but now it's about time. How much do you want to polish the scratches out? How many times are you willing to sit here in a contorted position with your body? I'm on a little step ladder. Some of you, based on your physical abilities of your body, will or will not be able to maintain that position very well. Never mind you see me still struggling to maintain control of the buffer. And the reason I put my hand way down here is because it's as close to this contact point as possible. So that is my goal into trying to control this. Like if I had a rotary polisher, it'd be even different and better because I could control it better. This is extremely difficult to try to maintain control. So you can do this without putting your hand on the moving spindle itself. So that's why, if you're wondering why I'm not doing this, because it'd be harder to control. So let me do one more pass. Once again, following directions, this second, actually, this will be the fourth time around. Approximately a half a teaspoon of compound. I'm gonna go over the heavy marks again and see. As I suspected, every time I make a new pass, it diminishes the scratches more and more. So let me add this caution to you, because with Amazon, it's all about the reviews. Well, it's also, it's about as easy as a way to separate yourself from your money in the form of getting some type of purchase product. So the reviews is a starting place. The problem is very few people will be able to leave a review with enough or with a great enough of the picture to really come to a determining conclusion. What I mean by this is not all scratches are created equal. So you're gonna see reviews that will say, oh, this product sucks, it didn't remove the scratch. This product is the ninth wonder of the world, it removed all my scratches. Well, okay, that's a starting point. The problem is you don't know how much pressure they used. You don't know how fast their drill motor is spinning. You don't know how deep the scratches are. There's so many variables that you will not know, and they will not know how to tell you. And even if they can, like, oh yeah, I had these really, really deep scratches in my windshield, and the kit removed them flawlessly. Okay, well, how deep is really, really deep to that person versus the scratches on your windshield? You just won't know that. Also, how critical of an eye do they have? When they were done polishing it, did they rotate their car and check the results in all kinds of lighting? Did they leave the review and then a day later they're out driving in their car and suddenly the sun shines and captures it in a different angle and the horror is revealed in front of their eyes, which is, oh my gosh, I thought I removed all the scratches, but there they are. That product actually sucks. Point is, there's just so many variables. So I'm gonna leave my 2 cents based on my years of experience, which is all the different types of glass polishes I have tried all use that same ingredient, cerium oxide, which I may not even be pronouncing correctly. They all use that abrasive. They all use what's called a glass polishing pad. It's a very dense pad. The kits seem to be universal in that capacity. So far, I've not had that much luck in polishing out, and by out, I mean completely gone, scratches from glass. I've had luck in diminishing the scratches so that it's now at an acceptable level. So I've had luck with that. What I wanted to do today was specifically pick the most popular, the top rated kit on Amazon and put it to the test. So based on my experience with all the other glass polishing kits and compounds and pads, yes, it performs. Is it perfect? Well, it depends on your interpretation of perfect. I have to accept that glass is very tough. It is a very hard material. It would be unrealistic to think that I can make a single pass. You know why? Because if there was something that aggressive that I could just get in a single pass, guess what would also happen? Is that I would have all kinds of valleys and swirl marks, just like you can create on paint, in my glass. So that's where, as a manufacturer, I've got to, let's call it, dumb it down to some degree, because I know that Johnny consumer is gonna get a drill motor in his hands. He's gonna be in his driveway or his garage, and he's just gonna go to town on his windshield. I don't wanna be responsible for producing a product and compound that's so aggressive that it will remove all the scratches instantaneously, because I also know that if it was that aggressive and strong, the likelihood of damaging the windshields in a bad way is great. So it's that trade-off of what's acceptable results and what's appropriate based on a novice or a beginner attempting to perform a job like this himself. So, in that context, which is a lot of variables, I'm gonna give this a thumbs up. Always check the description box below each video. There's gonna be links. It'll take you to my website for greater information. And actually what I wanna do is show this in different lighting to see what we have. So let's do that. Now that I've inspected it in the sun, I'm gonna give it a thumbs up. Yes, with a very critical eye, I can still see the scratches, but it does not stand out when I'm driving the car. So based on the do-it-yourself experience and how cheap this kit is, I could recommend this all day long. Just accept that the deeper your scratches are, the less results you're gonna get.
But what it really does do with the deep scratches that are right through here is it literally polishes away all the edges. And it's those sharp edges that catch the light and really create an unwanted glare. So this has diminished all the edges. It has not polished away all the scratches other than the very, very subtle ones. The deep ones still remain, but I'm okay with that. Here is the inside. Who knows how much will or will not light up, but the scratches, and you can literally see them, at least I can. They're still visible, but I can tell that all the edges have been worn down. And so it's almost like this textured effect. Man, my hand is shaking all over the place. I'm like so hungry, my body's starting to feed on itself and I'm getting the shakes. So I can see a textured effect, but it's no sharp edges and I'm not catching any glare from the sunlight. So as a driver looking through the front windshield, I'm gonna say that that is a winning trade-off for the amount of effort, the cost of the kit, the ability to do it myself. I'm gonna call that the winning balance. Of course, I accept that I could go over this again and again and again until I was just completely worn out or all the compound was used and diminish that even more and more and more. But right now, I'm gonna call this the winning balance based on all the other factors.